vida.
I got an
amen.
Amen. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, sitting on the throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above were the seraphim, each with six wings, with two wings that covered their faces, and with two wings that covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is filled of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the door posts and the threshold shook, and the temple was full with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips. I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." The seraphim flew to me with live coal in his hand, which he had taken from the tongs, with tongs from the altar. So it was hot, right? He touched my lips and said, "See that this touches your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sins atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am. Send me." Amen. So we are going to go through this thing, but there's a couple of things that I have to touch on. So the Lord has had me going through, I just read a book, Mary's Heart in Martha's World. Okay, and so I've been just going through this and just kind of thinking, what was the position, what was the mind frame of Martha, right? Why was she so detached while the Lord, when she was in the presence of the Lord? Amen. We need to be purposeful about the presence of the Lord. Amen. She was in a position. Let's just go through the scripture quickly. I'm just going to read it so then I can talk about it and you guys can follow me. Amen. It's in Luke chapter 10, verse 38. Now it happened. Are you there with me? A couple minutes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We're going to go, you can put a little marker in Isaiah because we're going back there. That is a lot to chew on, amen?
Amen.
Now it happened as they went that he entered into a certain village and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she said to her sister called Mary, who sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was so distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, "Lord, not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore she called to him to help. Therefore tell her to help me." And the Lord answered and said to her, "Martha, Martha, you worry and trouble about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen the right part," the good part. I don't like this translation, but praise God. "Which will not be taken from her." Amen?
Amen.
And so what we're seeing here is someone that is distracted but trying to cover it up with service, right? Because her heart was to serve, but by Jesus' presence, she allowed herself to be burdened.
Yeah.
Because the purpose of her service was off. In this earlier scripture, this first meeting, her scripture was off. You can tell that there's love there because she felt comfortable talking to the Lord. But she knew there was something in her that was not ready to receive the Lord. Right? She didn't come to in a position as she sees her sister at Jesus' feet. Instead of realizing what the right position was, what she needed to do to be in the right position in order to clear her house and lift her load, she allowed the circumstances to take over. She allowed herself to be displaced. Amen. There's a lot of us, the service itself is not the problem here, right? It was the line and the position of worship that she was not in.
Yeah.
This is what I was kind of meditating about. It was the position of worship that was off, right?
Right.
It was the lack of sacrifice, lack of self-worth.
Yes.
And you got to understand what I'm getting to as we go through the scripture here. But like, there wasn't a problem with the service, because all of us serve in a deeper way. But we need to come with a spirit of worship in all that we do.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Come back to, if you will, walk back with me to Isaiah 6 as we go through this. Amen?
Amen.
There's some, oh my goodness, there's a part in the book, and I love this book, I really enjoyed it, and I am passing along, and Peter has it now, where the Lord was in a room waiting to speak to her. And initially, she was in the room right there with the Lord. And he told her in the conversations, I will always be here. And of course, then things start to speed up, right? And we start walking by that door. First, it was an hour or two in the room. Then it turned into an hour in the room. And then pretty soon, we're in there 10 minutes, right? We're in the room where we should be at the Lord's feet and listening to his words and understanding his instructions.
Yeah.
But then that room, that visit gets less and less, and pretty soon now we're just poking our head in there.
Right.
Because we have allowed, again, the world, the busyness, the way down, forgetting that we were light when we were in that room, forgetting that we were not heavy, that things were falling in line, that we had job, we had opportunities, but as soon as I pull through the Lord, I'm not diligently seeking him first anymore and wondering why the world is crashing by, because I put emphasis on the world instead of on Christ.
Amen.
And so now that room walking by, the Lord's just saying, I'm still here. I am still here, ready to receive you when you are ready. Amen. When you come with a willing spirit. Amen?
Amen.
So starting at the top, hallelujah, where are we? Hallelujah, Isaiah, amen. And the train of his robe filled the temple. The train symbolizes royalty and power, right?
Yes, yes.
Just the train, just the tip filled the room. Just the tip. In Luke 8:44, she came behind, remember, and she just touched the edge and was healed. Amen. We want to understand how much power was in what the scene looked like in Isaiah's eyes when he's watching this scene. It is filled, the room, the power and the anointing of God, if we're just touching the edge. That's why the Lord, you don't want us to give up on that 10 minutes. Don't make it zero.
Right.
He wants the 10 minutes to grow, but don't give up on that 10 minutes, because even if you're just touching the hill,
yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
There's a blessing there. Amen. There's an anointing there.
Yeah.
There's help there.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jesus.
All right.
And so, above where he was, the seraphim came in that room, right? And they began to praise the Lord. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is filled of his glory. This is, I am jumping over because these are the same angels. You guys realize this? Revelation 4:8 talks about the same angel that came to praise the Lord. This is a blessing, right? Where's Jesus, there comes blessing, there comes praise, there comes worship. Automatically, right? If we're reading our word, we should be in the spirit of worship and praise.
Yeah.
Amen? This is what this is, hallelujah, this is what this is telling us, right? This is an authentic praise that was going forth as these angels were singing. They were in pursuit of God's holiness. We need to be in pursuit of God's holiness, recognizing when it's shifting, right? This morning, as we're walking in our prayer walk, how it begins to shift.
Yes.
The atmosphere begins to shift.
Yes.
We need to recognize that.
Yes.
When there's a change in the atmosphere, begin to praise and thank God immediately, because something has broken the atmosphere.
Hallelujah.
And we need to hold on to that praise.
Yes.
In Leviticus, and you can turn if you like, Leviticus 11, 44. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It says, I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourself and be holy because I am holy. Do not make yourself unclean by the creatures that move along the ground.
Yeah.
We need to take our holiness seriously. Let's take it to another level. I can't be holy, Lord. I'm not good enough. I'm asking you to give me praise and let me do the rest.
Right.
I know that you're broken. Amen?
Yeah.
I know that you're broken. I went to a conference with LaShawn, and we went to, it was just a little bitty church, and the lady had recently lost her first lady pastor, and she was in a position where you could tell there was just a sense of something lost there. They didn't connect at the end. There was something that happened between her first lady, and her in the relationship. And she was saying how, Lord, she didn't give me what I needed. Lord, she didn't do what she was supposed to do with me. And the Lord spoke through the power of the Holy Spirit and said to her, did you allow her to go through her valley? Did you allow her to deal with the pain that she was dealing with? Did you ever take a moment to pray for her and see what was going on?
Wow.
Church, we, us four pastors, we never commit or say that we're perfect. There's no way that we can be.
Man.
We are just people.
Yeah.
We are asking, if you notice that I'm in a valley, and I'm in a funk, and I am not connecting to you as I normally would, I need you to pray for me. At the sound of the voices, the door closed and the threshold shook the temple and filled it with smoke. Woe to me, I cry. I am ruined. I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among the people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Do you realize that this man is confessing?
Yeah.
He realizes that he is not perfect. And he's saying, Lord, why are you showing me all this? I'm not worthy. I am not worthy to see all what you have before me right now. Why are you giving me this? What makes me so I can, why do I deserve to see what you're doing right now in the spiritual realm? Why are you putting this on me? You are not worthy by yourself, right? We are to walk as living sacrifices. Amen? We are supposed to die to ourselves so that the Lord can raise us up. Of course we're not worthy.
Right.
Of course not. But through Christ, we can do all things.
Yeah.
Through Christ, we are made worthy.
Yeah.
Go to Romans 12 and 1. You guys know this one. Amen?
Yeah.
Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. Holy. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Holy and pleasing. This is true and proper worship. Amen?
Yeah.
The word sacrifice in Hebrew is karban. This is to draw near. The Lord is asking us to draw near to Him. We spend too much time flexing in our sin or flexing in other people's sin. It might not even be our sin, but sometimes we just watch as good innocent bystanders. We just watch it. Let's go. You didn't ball, hold, amen? You didn't ball through our prayer. We can't just let stuff just stand by. Amen?
Right.
Let's use that thing in the Spirit and drawing near to Christ. Follow me in Scripture to Hebrews 10 and 1. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. The law is only a shadow of good things that are coming, but not reality themselves. For this reason, it could never, by the same sacrifice, repeat endlessly year after year, making perfect those saints who draws near to worship. Hebrews 7 and 19, I'll just read this. The law made nothing perfect, but it's better to hope an introduction, right, by which we are drawn near to God. We are to draw near to God. Amen. All these rules and all these regulations mean nothing if we're not pulling ourselves to God.
Amen.
Amen. If we're not looking at ourselves and understanding what it means to get revealed before the Lord and drawing ourselves, right? Putting all these things that we put up as a post that says that I'm in good shape doesn't mean anything if you're truly not in good shape. If you not have not allowed yourself to break down before the Lord and come to Him and submit to Him and allow Him to change and deal with you, right?
Right.
We are not ever going to be perfect. There is not a situation where we can stand that we think that we could be better. We like to pretend. We like to stand and pretend that everything is good instead of asking for help. Instead of being before that word and getting naked before God and asking for help and asking, finding ways to draw near. Sometimes we think we're so far on the outside of that that there's no way to draw back in. And God is constantly pulling us back in. I'm still sitting in that room.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for you.
Yeah.
I'm waiting for you. There's nothing we can do. We think that, oh, I've done the worst sin ever in life. No, you haven't, dear. There's always someone else.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter anyway because their sin does not, is not your business.
Right.
It's you. You have to get right with God.
Right.
When we as individuals, we want to save the world and we're not even right yet, right? We're so worried about that other person a lot of times, but if we were standing in example and we had ourselves right, then that other person can fall in line because we're standing as an example.
Yeah.
They see how to do it. We want to push an example instead of show an example.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Right.
Let's go to Ephesians 2 and 3. Hallelujah. Desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. I'm going to go to 4:2. But because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy. Amen?
Yes.
Hallelujah. We're deserving of wrath. We're already talking about this. We know that we're deserving of wrath. We forget the work that was done on the cross. We don't take it seriously. That is atoned for, right? Even with daily choices, I was talking to someone this week about this, is that daily choices have become a burden to me at times. I am putting so much weight on a daily, even when it comes down to what kind of phone to get. Girl, just make a decision to walk in. Amen?
Amen.
Like, seriously, like, we pray about it and we believe that God has done something about it, but then we question every decision that's made. Why is that? If we're really trusting on what God's doing in our life, if we are being moved and directed by the Holy Spirit, then why will we allow ourselves to be captured in a thought?
Yeah.
In a ridiculous thought that had nothing to do with the Lord. In the Chuck Smith, that book that Nicole has, was reading, why are we so confused? We don't know whose voice it is, if it's the flesh, if it's Satan, or if it's God. Why do we know that?
Amen.
We have to know when it's God speaking to us. If we don't know when it's God speaking to us, then we are not studying hard enough, folks. We're not praying hard enough.
Right.
We're not spending our time with the Lord.
That's right.
We're missing too many Wednesday night Bible studies. Amen. Sandy picked up a Friday night. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God, because we got to be in front of Him. We got to break those things that are constantly attacked. We are being attacked daily.
Yeah.
When you realize that there's something going on in the spiritual realm and that you are being attacked.